بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم ألهمنا مراشد أمورنا وأعذنا من شرور أنفسنا. Yesterday we began a discussion. We were reading a bit from a kitab written by a very great scholar of Islam, Moulana Abu al-Hasan Ali Nadwi rahimullah. Hazrat Moulana had a great unique foresight, and he had very great tabahur. He was very deep in the history of the past. He had studied history so well that this world normally rotates on that same circle. So the man who is a master of the past, he's going to be well aware of the future. So in many countries when he went, he just looked at the country and he told them that you're all going to see this. And waqi, as he told it to them, they saw it. And when they would come and say to him, like, how you knew, then for him he would say, like, it was obvious. Unique he was in his knowledge, unique, deep. Recently in one lecture we mentioned, when Masjid al-Aqsa was taken, and he was an alim who was an alim of the non-Arab, he was an alim of the Arabs also. Allah had blessed him with a very sweet tongue in the Arabic language. So where he was in great esteem and awe in the non-Arabic lands, in the Arab lands also he was the boss. And at the time when there was a complete decline because of the Khilafat falling, and then when Al-Aqsa was taken, that was like the biggest shock at that time. So he also made his dora in the Arab countries. He was invited for so many lectures. It was a time where the entire Arab world had like lost himmat. The Muslim world had lost himmat. Aqsa is taken. So at that time he wrote one kitab. That kitab itself gave life to the world. He wrote, "Mada khasir al-alam bi inhitatil muslimin." Then translation will explain to you what a mind he had. He said, because of the collapse of the Muslims at the present time, how the entire world has lost out. How the world has lost out because the Muslims at the moment slid. Where we will normally say, what happened to the Muslims? Couldn't you live up to the others? For him, there was no others. He said, all the others suffered because the Muslims came down. Had the Muslims been up, Islam would have been presented to them on the plate. They would have all looked with honor towards Islam and they would have got their Jannah. But because Islam went down, then it wasn't hoped that the non-Muslim was then going to accept Islam. He said, the whole world has lost out today because the Muslims came sliding. Then in one seminar regarding why was Al-Aqsa taken, and many great scholars, politicians, so many people were brought and all of them mentioned unique points that what did we do wrong that in these 6 days Israel managed to capture like the center of the Muslim world, and there was no shortage of wealth, there was no shortage of soldiers. When we did it in school, my one friend even asked the question that Israel is so small, surrounded by the Arab lands, like how do you take, and you defeated all of them. All. This wasn't like one Badr where the Muslims were few and the enemy were a lot. This was the total opposite. But if you go into the history, you will understand it was a made-up victory. The victory had happened long before that. They were brought onto that. The arms were ready. You were not there perhaps in that time, but we all have heard about, example, the Gulf War. So in the Gulf War, again it was a thought that how did Iraq get such a hiding from America? But when you go a little into the history, you will see that Saddam Hussein at that time was the puppet of America. Later on he changed according to what we understood. He made a unique repentance later on. But at that time he was their puppet. So the books of history even show that his going into Kuwait at that time, for whatever reason they went, was on the command of his boss. That you go into Kuwait. So for him, what a shock it came that as soon as his soldiers went into Kuwait, the announcement was made that America is standing in defense. Because he would say, but you're all the ones who told me. And then to try to fight now against that in force that is invading, which was now America, and Saudi hardly took part in this thing. It was just like America, Saudi was a name. So the first thing you will say, what's happening? Like our friend became our enemy overnight, but it was ready already. So then all their pilots went running for their planes. But those planes were many years ago bought from who? From that same America. So that plane that's bought from the enemy is not going to fly when you want it to fly. So many of their jets never took off that day. So many of their jets never took off. And they never knew why. The answer was obvious. You don't buy from your enemy your weapons. Then the second thing is they had hidden many of their jets. If you have a desert, then you hide it in that sand dune. So it's completely covered. They never understood how America knew where it was. So when they bombed, they hit on those spots. Because when you buy from the enemy, he knows where his toys are. You can hide it under the earth also. It will come looking for it. So it was not that the enemy were much more stronger. It was planned from long before. This Israeli war was planned from before. Puppets were already put up into the different lands. What was going to happen in those 6 days wasn't sudden, it was only sudden for the alam of Islam. Otherwise a lot of planning had taken place. Who will come, who won't come, where you will attack from, where you will not attack from. Everything was ready. But after this defeat, so many people gave reasons why we took this. One of the biggest would have been, which I don't think anyone at that time said it, is we made friends with the wrong people. That Israel is not our friend, but America is also not our friend. But until recently, whenever the United Nations sat down, it was always hoped America will solve this problem. From day one it was supposed to be said that he is the biggest liar. Biggest liar. And alhamdulillah now at least, in this last 3-4 years, things are changing. A lot is changing. So at that time, he gave a bayan. And you will see what was his mind of the world and how it works. So he started his bayan like this, that everyone is shocked. How did we lose Aqsa today? He said, for so many years, I was living in shock that how come we have not lost Aqsa? That was his knowledge of the future. That I was living in shock, how come we have not lost it? And then he said, gave an example to make the people say, and he even said, you will be amazed at like what I'm saying. He said, when you see that aeroplane in the sky, that aeroplane is defying whatever law there is, whether it's the law of gravity or the law of whatever is heavy must come down. Whatever the law is, that aeroplane defied it all. It went so high in the sky and how it's moving that the people in the aeroplane are so calm and relaxed. So when we look at it also, then nobody ever thinks what made it reach there because we only see it going calm. But if you ever sat in that aeroplane, you will understand that amount of power that was needed to push it up. If that fuel was not there, it was not going to reach where it reached. And if that bang beforehand, and as it's high in the air, just because we can't hear or see that fuel burning, it shouldn't make us think there's no fuel burning. Because that pilot understands if that fuel comes to an end, my beautiful aeroplane is crashing to the ground. He said, for so many years, I saw the plane of Islam moving in the sky. But I saw there was no talk of refueling. And I always wondered that for how long is it still going to remain in the sky? Then he said, what fuel am I speaking about? He said, it's the fuel that put that plane up. What a mind he had. What a mind. He said, when Allah's Nabi came, he came to a nation that were regarded by the world that we don't even need to rule over you. There was no threat from the side of the Arabs, no threat at all. There was no talk of them one day ruling the world. When Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I see the palaces of Rome, then it was a talk amongst the hypocrites, like, and what big dreams he got. That we're struggling in the small land of Arabia and he's talking about the superpowers of the time. What dreams? Said at that time there was no major Muslim army. Said when Allah's Nabi came sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he brought such a fuel to his Sahaba. Such a fuel that took them from beneath the earth to the top of the skies. Said, what was that fuel? He said, he showed them the picture of Jannah. He mentioned three things, but this was the main. He described to them the picture of Jannah in such a manner that after that, whatever the world had to offer became zero. He painted the picture and he reminded them so many times that in his blessed company, he says, he brought Jannah closer, 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 closer to them. Until every Sahabi started saying, how can I get it? He even wrote that it seemed their hand went out for the fruit of Jannah. But they just found it's not coming in my hand. Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself said, on one occasion he was performing salah, and then he moved front. And then he moved back. And after that they said, we saw you doing something today which you never did. He said, in my salah, Allah showed me Jannah. And he showed me that fruit of Jannah. And I went front, and it was told, not now. He said, had I taken that bunch, you would have been eating from it till the ending. He said, then Allah showed me the fire of Jahannam, and I moved back. He said, but he brought that picture so close to his Sahaba, that they also put their hand for it. And when they couldn't find it, then they asked, what's stopping us? And then he said, death. The bridge of death. Are you ready to cross? He said, seeing that picture, every Sahabi of his became ready to jump, not to cross. He said, when death became more beloved to them than everything else, their aeroplane took off into the sky. They soared in the world because every battle they went, they did not go looking for victory. They went looking for martyrdom. He said, so high they took that aeroplane that it remained in that skies. And when I would look at it, I would always wonder, because the narration had come that until you will be gripped with wahan. Wahan means weakness. Sahaba radiallahu anhu asked, what is this weakness you are speaking about? When the enemy will become ghalib over us. Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, like how you will be on a table and people will be just plucking what they want. He said, a time will come where the world will invite one another against you. So the Sahaba got surprised and they said, will it be min qillatin nahnu yawma idhin ya Rasulallah? On that day will it be that our numbers will again become little? He said, no, the opposite. He said, you will be so much. He said, but you will be like that foam that's on top of that waves. It looks so big, but when you touch it, there's nothing inside it. Nothing. He said, you will be like the dirt that comes to the top of the waters. He says, when wahan will grab you, then Allah will remove your fear from the hearts of your enemy and will put their fear in your hearts. May Allah make us think, do I really love death so much or am I scared of death? Because if I am scared of death, maybe that's the reason why I'm so scared of the enemies who bring death also. We are all scared of death. And don't run away from a reality. When Allah's Nabi said it to the world, he never said it shouting them. He said, I am giving you the solution to your sickness. That we have been gripped with a wahan. They asked, what is this weakness? He said, love of this world and a dislike for death. Now it has to be changed, that whole thing. And then he told at the ending, and it's nothing to lose hope for. He says, because the day we will recreate this in our children, our aeroplane is going back in the skies. Back in the skies. And we have hope that we're very close to that. Very close. That aeroplane is going up. The question is, who's going to be the passengers now? That aeroplane is going because it was mentioned, it's the law, like, although it's not like a definite law, but history has shown it. That at the end of the 100 years, the thing changes completely. The revolution comes again. So very soon we will be reaching that 100 years where Al-Aqsa will say, bas now. I can't stand these Jews for any longer. It has never kept the enemy in it for more than 100 years. Bukhte Nasr was the mightiest of kings of his time in Babylon. When he conquered Al-Aqsa and he brought it to the ground, that was the one that Sulaiman alayhi salam built. He was so strong, and there was no for the Bani Israel hope of anyone. Because they had no warriors. The mighty Bukhte Nasr, who would ever destroy? From the scholars that he killed, then there were those that were left and he took them back with him far away. Babylon is Iraq. This was the lands of Sham. At that time, the Anbiya alayhi salam, the Nabi of the time, said to the people, Allah has promised you help is coming. They wondered, where will help come from? History says most likely his name was Cyrus. In one very strong opinion, this is the Zulqarnain Quran speaks about. He was not of them, but he was inspired. Bukhte Nasr died, his son had taken rule. It was an empire that the world thought will never come to an end. They said, the sun never sets on this empire, the sun set on it. And the Bani Israel came back. But when Al-Aqsa fell, at that time a Nabi of Allah walked past the ruins of Al-Aqsa. And he knew of Bukhte Nasr, and the power of Bukhte Nasr, and the weakness of the Bani Israel. So he asked this question, Anna yuhyi, that how will Allah ever bring life back to this land? What a question he asked. فَأَمَاتَهُ اللَّهُ مِئَةَ عَامٍ ثُمَّ بَعَثَ. Almighty Allah said, we let him die for 100 years, and then we told him, stand up. What happened when he was dead, and when he was told to stand? Quran speaks about that his own body and the things that were around him. When he stood up, he said, look at that, look at that. He understood it's 100 years. And then when he looked and he found Al-Aqsa was back again. After about 70 years from the collapse, that revolution started. Cyrus came, most likely Zulqarnain. Bukhte Nasr's son was defeated. He offered the Bani Israel, you want to go back, we'll take you back. When they came there, they saw the land is finished. He said, we will give you aid, you will rebuild. They rebuilt it. The teaching started again. Everything started happening. It was not like what Sulaiman alayhi salam built, but they did it. Rebuilt it. And then he was told, stand up. 100 years later, this Nabi stands and he sees Aqsa is back. Everything is back. History showed the second time Al-Aqsa went was in Islamic history. When the Crusaders took Al-Aqsa. When they entered at that time again, there was no hope. In one place we wrote about it, that after they conquered Al-Aqsa, it wasn't just one kingdom, they established 4 kingdoms in the lands of Sham. 4 kingdoms. That if you said to the Muslims, you'll have to fight against them, no, you have to fight against that kingdom, and that kingdom, and that kingdom. It was not just from England, it was not just from France, it was the united world. They all came in and they took it like their land. And they divided it into kingdoms. How mighty they were at that time. Again the world said, this is the end of Sham. But when Allah once, then someone just stood up, the world later on called him Salahuddin al-Ayyubi. But it wasn't only him. There were those before him. They started the revolution. And he just brought it to the peak. When he entered Al-Aqsa and he wrote a letter to his sheikh, The Sheikh wrote a letter back to him. He says the head is still in sajda. He says that the land that never heard Allah's name for the last 99 years or 90 years, in the land where masjids were made stables and where people had lost hope of Allah's name ever being taken, the land of Al-Aqsa. When Israel took it, the world perhaps got shocked that this is the end. Islam got a unique tariq that our aeroplane can fly back again. It's just that, as I mentioned, when it's going to go back, and it is going to go, then who's going to be the passengers? If me and you want to enter, you need your ticket. The ticket for that plane is you will be asked, like how today they'll say, let's do a screening. Do you have the virus or not? There it will be asked, do you have wahan or not? Wahan, you'll ask, what's this wahan? They'll say, a dislike for death and a love for the world. In this world, you can still beat the system. No matter how much they try, they don't know what South Africa is. But in South Africa, behind the counter, you'll find every certificate. They can try how much they want to. But on that aeroplane, you will not get on. On that aeroplane, that thermometer will show exactly, do you have the love of this world so much that has made you dislike death? And we want to get on that aeroplane. We want to get. So Allah Tabarak Ta'ala created, perhaps, for what other reasons this COVID came in the world, many reasons. And fitan has always been there, conspiracies has always been there. And Almighty Allah, He uses the enemy also for the purpose of Islam. The plans of the enemy is used by Almighty Allah to reach a certain what Allah wanted in them, not what they wanted. وَمَكَرُوا وَمَكَرَ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ. The dua was, اللَّهُمَّ اجْعَلْ تَدْمِيرَهُمْ فِي تَدْمِيرِهِمْ. Allah, let there be destruction be in their own plan. تَدْمِيرَهُمْ فِي تَدْبِيرِهِمْ. So whatever they wanted to get out of this, let us take something good out of it. That this corona 1 year made us all realize we all scared of death. And again, there's no running away from the sickness. No running away. We are scared of death. And now we have to ask ourselves why. So the same what he mentioned, that the picture of Jannah has gone far, far, far away. Because of it, we also now got nothing to grab. We're just seeing sand. We need that picture to come better, closer, closer, closer. It has to come so close to us, so close to us, that we don't have to wait. When the wife of Fir'aun was being tortured because of her iman on Nabi Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, Asiya, her level of torture was very extreme. She was a very delicate woman. She was a queen. She lived in the best of luxuries, and then iman entered in the house of the Pharaoh. Everything was done to make her turn back. A disgrace that your own wife. So the torturers that worked on her body, what did they not try? Until a level came where it comes in certain narrations, they said they were seeing a smile on her face when they were abusing her. So what was that smile? They write is, Allah then opened the scenes of paradise. Quran mentions, and Allah gives the example of the wife of Fir'aun. إِذْ قَالَتْ رَبِّ ابْنِ لِي عِنْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ. When she said, Allah, build for me a house by you in paradise. At that time it was open. So she just smiled because her house was being shown. Smiled. Me and you have to work so much on our iman that even before Allah opens it, we must be able to look at death in the face and smile. We're reading about Imam Ghazali, rahimullah, now time. Perhaps you will reach the ending. But with the ending, when it comes at the death of Imam Ghazali, he passed away very young, at the age of 55. It's like he had a job, he came, he did the job so fast. At the age of 55, he wakes up, his brother was the witness. He narrates, he said, my brother, Imam Ghazali's name was Muhammad. Says, my brother Muhammad woke up. He went quickly to make wuzu. He performed 2 rakats salah. He said, can you bring me one kafan? He brought the kafan, he put it on his head, and he said, the command of my Lord is well accepted, and he passed away. The command of my Lord is well accepted, and he passed away. How happy he was. They say he even made his body in the position that I'm ready for the grave. So he turned on his right and he was gone. They smiled when death was coming. Why we are mentioning this is sometimes you might say that, you know, you're asking for high things, like that word Imam Ghazali is like a Nabi. That Allah that made Imam Ghazali is the one who will make ours also. When Mawlana Yusuf Rahimullah passed away, many people said, where will the work of Tabligh go now? That there's no Yusuf left, especially those who heard his bayanat. So most likely it was Hazrat Shaykhul Hadith Mawlana Zakariya Rahimullah who said that the giving hand has not changed. It's only the taking hand that has changed. That Allah who made, he was also a Muhammad. Why we decided to speak about this in this few months, it is called the night of Qadr. And we will search for that Qadr. And every time we are mentioning one meaning of Qadr is that night that makes the person valuable. That person who had no value. So me and you, normally when we come, we say, Allah, I come for my forgiveness, and we stop there. Perhaps because we think that, can I ask for anything more? Like when the criminal comes back to the court and finally he pleads guilty, and then the judge says, what do you want? Then the most he can say is that, you know what, wipe out my files. But he'll never dream of saying anything more, isn't it? You think he'll ever tell the judge and give me your daughter? He'll go back in jail. But the people of this ummah, they were told, when you ask, you look at Allah, you don't look at yourself. You don't look whether you are an addict, whether you are an abuser, you are a murderer, you are a killer. We are looking at that Allah that changes the world for sinners also. It is the night of power. You must have so much of hope in Allah that that place which is just under the Anbiya, I see that's my place. That. And then you start asking for. And you will ask in such a manner that, Allah, I won't accept anything less. And by Allah, there's no, I can't give you any income. By Allah, there's nothing bad. But you will also, and he will also. Aim high, and you will see Allah will give even higher. Don't just stop on this night. It's a night when you ask for the best. When Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told us, there's nothing better than the word called Jannatul Firdaus. Nothing better. He could have said, they don't have too high hopes. He said, there's so many Jannats. Just ask Allah to put us in Jannah. He said, when you ask Allah, ask for Firdaus. He said, when the Sahabi was told who made his khidmat, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Sal, ask. So he said, I ask to be your companion in paradise. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Awa ghayra dhalika. That, what about something else? He said, no, I only want that. And he could have told him that, you know, you're asking for the impossible. He said, fa'inni ala nafsik bi kathrati sujood. Then I need your help also. I will ask, but you make a lot of sajda to Allah. You do your part and we'll be companions in that world. Meaning, nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible. The one who the world said, I never knew he did any good action. They saw him in the dream that he was higher than everyone else. Nothing impossible. So with regards to Imam Ghazali, Rahimullah, We mentioned yesterday that Allah had given him the seat of knowledge. Until a thought came in his mind that I am not only looking for this. The fame, the name, the world, everything came to him. He was now looking for Allah. So he was ready to sacrifice it all. And he went out for 10 years, he stayed searching for Almighty Allah, that what is this to be sincere for my Rabb? And then when Allah brought him back, then in that few years that he came back, what work was taken from him? So we spoke about one of the trials of that time, fitan, was called philosophy. And why it was a big trial, it came with a lot of good. It was not only philosophy. There was other knowledges that came with it. Had it been that it was all rubbish, everyone would have picked up its rubbish. But the problem is when everything is good, or 90% is like powerful, and there's a 10% poison. That's what is called danger. That is what's called danger. When some people ask, must I take this vaccination or not? We say to them, the day you're going to be forced, just read a lot of Quran. Before you take it, after you take it. Then they say, but the results are so good. You say, that's the problem. Had the results not been good, from day one, if everyone was dying, no one will take it. But how do we know that from the 10 people who are getting the vaccination, 10 are really getting what they want to give us, or only one is getting and 9 are getting nothing? So after they say we vaccinated 100 people, and you know what? Only 5 died. But if you have to go into research, you'll find perhaps they only gave that thing to 5. And 95 others got an injection. Whether it was water, whether it was fluid, whether it was vitamin, who knows? Because the very enemy who brought it is the one dishing out the medicine. If you know the history of Africa, at the time when AIDS was spreading, how it was spreading, then the very ones who brought these sicknesses to our countries, before, besides AIDS and even others, South America once upon a time had a population, had its own world. Go in the books of history, they still don't want to mention what happened to the people of South America. There was no war there that killed them. Something destroyed their entire land. When the Americans entered South America, they were not the people living on the land. They were coming by boat. So South America had its own people. Whether they were good people or not, who knows, but it seems their character was very good. When you study it, you will see they had the character of like Muslims. So who knows whether they were even Muslims. But history doesn't want to say what did they bring to South America that made all of them die. Perhaps that time they also came and they said, hey, this one, sickness spreading. And I got the medicine. And said, see, he took the medicine, he got better. He took the medicine, you took the medicine. And then he said, you also take the medicine. And as that medicine was taken, if you see an ant hill, we don't know where the ants are. But that poison that they give is food. Then that ant will come and eat from the food, but he won't die. If he has to die there and there, the other ants are not going to die. He'll live. And he will live so long that he will be able to take it back to the hole. And when it reaches the hole, that poison becomes the death of all of them. We don't know what's coming in the future, but you don't ever trust your enemy. Don't ever. Problem is when everything looks good and they put a lie in between, you can't pick up the lie. When Sahaba radiallahu anhu heard, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, don't ever go to the fortune teller. So the Sahabi said, but sometimes he says that which is right. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that's the problem. Because if he says things that are not right, no one will believe him. You're going to give him 50 rand next time, you say you're rubbish. You stole my money. You told me next month I will take a second wife and my first one will be happy about it. You went and you had thrill, you took the second wife, finish, you're out of 2 houses. But if he says something which is right, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the jinn go and try to grab from the angels. And what they grab Wherever they grab it from, they bring it. So he gets the truth and he mixes it with lies. That one truth makes you have so much of conviction in him that we cannot accept he can be a liar after that. That's where we are living at the moment. Philosophy was that. When he wrote his book, he wrote that what part we have no problem with Western education, you can call it today, and where we have the problem. That it is not the entire thing is the devil's, but in it is definitely the devil. And when someone asks, what's the alternative? So up till now we used to say there's still no alternative. Alhamdulillah, we are again on the verge of a revolution. It was just about a few months ago when the president of Turkey made this announcement. When he was cutting the ribbon at a new institute, he said, for too many years, we were taking our education from the West. He said, it is time that the world must take their education from us. He said, we are not followers in this game, we are the leaders. That statement of his is a dream for us. That we have never been against education, but we knew that the lie is in it. That boy goes and he becomes, what a wonderful accountant, what a wonderful lawyer, what a wonderful doctor. But when he comes back to us, he also comes with the doubts on Almighty Allah's existence. He comes and he says to us, but this issue of Darwin is not like how you're saying it. He is ready to say it to us. And then if I tell him, are you a hafiz of Quran? Then I read one verse where Allah says, and we made Adam. And then we sent him down. And the boy just goes quiet. That I never even knew that Allah spoke about that Adam was created. But can there be any truth in a system of evolution? So we will never say no. We will say the problem is there could be so much of truth in it. And the main point is the lie. There could have been creation before Adam a.s. There was definitely jinn. And the nature of the jinn at that time could be different from today's. There could have been animals in that time. And they could have been huge in size. All of that, if they say this rock shows this and shows this and shows this, we say all accept it. But why must you then say, and this became Adam? Why don't you listen to us when we got the knowledge from the one who made it all? That yes, there was a lot of creations, and then chapter closed. When the angels saw Adam a.s. being created, they even said to Allah, that Allah, are you going to put in earth now another one who will make facade on earth? Why another one? Because before Adam alayhi salam, there was already facade on earth. That's where Iblis came from after that. So lot of truth, but that poison is called kufr. Poison is kufr. We will end on this inshallah. We were speaking about Imam Ghazali and how he went for this philosophy. May Allah make our children that we don't go into the universities and say, sir, whatever you say on my head and my heart and my entire body. Rather, the boy of Iman, he goes and he says that I got a Quran and you got a theory. I got news from the creator of the heavens and you got a story from a computer. I got calculations from the one who's the most accurate in all calculations. And you, the one who yesterday you said the sun is so many billion light years away. And 5 years later you added another zero to it. That one zero means it's gone so much further. Your calculation is so off between the heavens and the earth. You will not understand. Study this, what we call science today, and we're so shocked. Every few years, the whole story changes. The whole story, but because we only live in one era, they don't want to even say in school, you know, just before you were born, the story was something else. It changes so fast. May Allah make it that if we are in a school or in a university, At the moment it has reached the theory of Darwin evolution, which is open kufr. But it's not going to stop now. It has gone now to one level more. That the nature of man, what is your body? What is your desire? What is normal and natural? What is not natural? And there they will say to the child, it is natural to be you. And that sentence, natural to be you, is the worst lie. Meaning if you feel an inclination to your teacher, then be you, go up to the teacher and say, sir, I don't only want you to teach me, I want you to touch me. You, be you. And if the teacher looks at the student and he says, I don't want to only teach you, I want to touch you, be you. And if the one boy is told, sit next to another, before it was girl, they say, be you. If you find a feeling, it's natural. Biggest lie, but so much of truth behind it. The truth was that yes, you will find a feeling. Because the devil blows the arrow anywhere. You will find the feeling sometimes to another pretty girl. Maybe you're only 11 years old. You're still young. Your father might say to you, you're not even baligh. But already when you see Aisha, things start happening. You don't ride straight. It's moving. But now you're shy now because I'm too small. Natural. That part was the truth. Be you, you natural. But give in to your desire. That is what Quran said. Where Allah Tawarakala said, فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا. Yes, we, meaning Allah, put desire in. وَتَقْوَاهَا. And we also put it in you, the ability to say no. That one they will not say. That's the lie. Everything else was the truth. That yes, in the world there's a lot of girls who like girls. So when they come for their marches, we are not saying you're mad. And there are a lot of boys who perhaps like boys, and we will not say you mad. But when you say I want to do what I feel, that's when you say you really mad. Because if today you're going to do whatever you want, will you ever stop? That's where the lie is. Quran, فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا. We put in man the desire to do the worst of evils. وَتَقْوَاهَا. We put him in the ability to say no. And we all have it. May Allah Tawarakala bless us in the night of Qadr. Every one of us can become the Ghazali of the era. That we can see the lie in such a manner that we can be ready to give our life to speak out against the lie. And to create so much truth in the world that the next generation must remember every one of us that it was through you that you saved my iman. وآخر دعوانا الحمد